My lungs were punctured and all of my organs were torn. And I woke up, even though I was conscious, not exactly sure of how I'd gotten here. And I had an even less clear idea of what the rest of my life would look like. And there was only, in that moment, whenever I feel unsure, I try to just focus on the one thing that I do know. And in that moment, the one thing that I did know was that by some crazy miracle, I was still alive. And I realized in that moment that that was what gave me hope. And as I laid in that ICU, not being able to talk, I realized that I had a choice. I had a choice between those two very disparate feelings, right? Helplessness or hope. And I'm very lucky in that moment, I chose hope. And the process by which I chose hope helped me to take my horizontal world and try to build it back to something even looking like normal, degree by very tiny degree. Mm-hmm. Now, it wasn't a simple choice, but it was meaningful. And what I learned on my journey from a broken life to a beautiful one is what I want to share with you all today. My hope is that these insights will help you whenever you find challenges, because there is this idea that if there's pain without catharsis or helpfulness, then it's just wasted hurt. And if there's in any way, in any shape or form that my story can help you, then that will make everything worthwhile. So I really appreciate you giving me the chance to speak with you. Now, my not dying under the weight of an 18-wheeler was a miracle, but I did not behave in a way that was anything sent from heaven. There was no halo. I did an unbelievable amount of crying. Like, not just like a little bit, but like a lot. And I threw myself, I don't call it a pity party, it was a pity rager. The cops would have been called on how badly I was feeling for myself. And like, if there had been an award that was given for feeling sorry for yourself, it would have been about 6 feet tall, and it would have just been like a picture of like my weeping face. I'm sure that you can imagine that this went very splendidly for me. And for all the people around me, they thought I was a joy. They just couldn't get enough of me. But I had one day, and I had a moment where I was just tired of hearing myself complain about the same things over and over again. And I wanted to move my life forward so that, you know, as a typical New Yorker, I could complain about new things. You know, the subway is too crowded. Who's touching me? Who's that person who's looking at me? Why are there so many tourists on Fifth Avenue? Why can't the barista at Starbucks get my name right? It's Katie. It's not that hard. You know, all the exciting stuff. I had to accept that this was my reality and that no amount of feeling sorry for myself and complaining was going to change that fact. That if I wanted for something to change, I had to do it myself. And I had to try to move forward. So in that moment, I tried to assess myself, right? At this point, I had no feeling from my ribcage down. And I was still in a hospital bed with no idea about when they said that I would be able to come home. So I wasn't able to breathe on my own, but I was able to speak, which was amazing. And my brain still functioned, which was unbelievable, because it shouldn't have been that way. But I found that I could, it was unbelievable that there wasn't a traumatic brain injury. It should have been. And it was, the doctors told me that I missed the cab of the truck by only 3 inches. So if the cab had run me over, then I would have absolutely died. And that the fact that my head didn't hit the ground is what saved me. Also, my being conscious is what allowed for me to ask what hospital I wanted to go to, because you do have patients' rights. So I wound up going to a better trauma hospital than the hospital that was closest, where the doctors had told me that I would have definitely died. But in this moment, I took this miracle, which was my ability to have my brain function, and I thought, what can I do? What are things that make me feel like me? And for me, being able to make people laugh is the greatest gift you can give. I feel like it's its own kind of magic, that the idea that something you say can make someone feel good. And that felt like the perfect place to start. the first night that my best friends were able to come to see me, and these are friends that I've had since I've been about 5 years old, they came into the ICU, and I'm hooked up to all of these machines. Things are taking stuff out, they're putting stuff back in, helping me to breathe, and I basically look like a cup of straws with the face of a girl. And I'm in a hospital gown, and I still have gravel in my hair from the accident. And
turn around, honey.
Like, they're coming from their administrative assistant jobs. Like, they're not, they have no idea what's going on, and they're so awkward, and they have, like, they're an arm's length away, and I felt awkward in front of these people who saw me in the worst outfits I've ever worn in my entire life. Now I'm feeling weird. One of my friends, Karen, she came into the room and she looked at me and she goes, "Oh my God, Katie, you look so good." And I was like, "Karen, do I look good, or do I look, I just got run over by a truck?" And suddenly, in this unbelievably uncontrollable situation, I felt in control. I felt like myself. And that was absolute magic. And I started to think of that as a small bite and also as a little victory, as a way to regain control in a small way. During this time, the one thing that I couldn't control was the pain that my body was in. I was given a morphine pump for my pain, and it was so bad that they allowed for me to have morphine pumped into my veins every 3 minutes. And they had given me a fentanyl patch that was enough for a 350-pound man with cancer. And once I got off of the morphine pump, I was on 300 milligrams of Oxycontin a day just to be able to get through my day. So it was, you know, casual. It was just Thursday. So that was something that I knew that I couldn't control. And the problem was is that no matter how much medicine I got, I always wanted more. And that scared me, because when you're talking about opioids and not peanut M&Ms, things can go very sideways. So I tried to think about what I could do. So the first hour, I checked how many times I pressed the morphine pump. And then the next hour, I tried to do it one less time. And if I did it that one less time every hour or every day, like I'd have a goal, one less today. And if I did that, I would be so incredibly proud of myself. I would like tell everybody that came in, I was like, "One less pump on that morphine pump." I don't know. Do you guys know that happened? It was really good. The doctors were like, "Yes, we're worried about you dying of sepsis. Like, please, just." But I was still very excited. That also happened with my physical therapy, in that I knew that I wouldn't immediately jump up and just start walking, that it was going to be a slow process. But as long as I tried my best every day and did a little bit better, then that felt like it was a win. Something else that I learned while I was recovering that has become really a big part of my life is that we need to really celebrate those small victories. You know, those little moments that sometimes get lost because we're focusing on the big things. As women especially, we're so hard on ourselves. We want to be the best parent, the best wife, the best person at our jobs, and we only feel excited or proud and feel okay about celebrating when it's the big things. When it's the raise, or we lose 10 pounds, or else it doesn't even count. And as a person who has strung her life back together by celebrating these small victories, I have to say, you deserve to celebrate them. Celebrate everything. For me, I do it with cookies. I finally, not took down my Christmas decorations. I did that on December 1st. Excuse me, January 1st, December 1st. I just put them up in different but I took them down, and they've been sitting in a box just like winking at me, being like, "Baby, we should go someplace." I finally did it this week, and I celebrated with as many Milanos as I could put directly into my face. Aww. And high-fiving myself, which is awkward, because if you do it in front of anybody, it just like looks like one clap. So like, that isn't what I'd highly recommend. But the Milanos, yes. I've always been a pretty happy and optimistic person. And I think that part of this was because I lived a very beautiful and sincerely a very easy life before this. I had a good job before this accident happened. I lived in Brooklyn. I had a bunch of friends. You know, the world felt like it was my oyster. I went from this life of yeses to a world of no. No, you can't leave the hospital. No, Katie, you'll probably never walk again. No, you can't have that extra pudding cup. The other two were really upsetting, but the third one just felt like it didn't gut. Enough. But suddenly here I was in this heartbreaking pain. And I felt imperfect and unlovable and so broken that I couldn't help myself but hate myself. And in that very dark time, something really incredible happened. My family and my friends started to show up when I was the worst version of myself. They showed up in texts and in calls, and most amazingly, they showed up at the hospital with six packs of beer and bottles of wine in their work bags. Because if I couldn't go to happy hour, they were going to bring happy hour to me.
There you go, Link.
And they had those like little bodega cups that you get that had like the blue writing, you know, thank you for being our customer. And they would open it up and they'd stand around my hospital bed and they'd give me a couple sips. Don't worry, the doctor said it was cool. And also, I'm Irish, so I'm basically 75% Jewish anyway. It was just like a very casual by mouth blood transfusion. And what it did in that moment was made me realize that we don't always have to be this next level person in order to be loved. And that the moments that we show up for each other, we don't realize what an impact they have on others until they're in a bad place. Those moments were light in the darkest time of my life, and I will never ever forget the beauty of hearing, you know, a Bud Heavy can open in room 501 at Denny. It was absolutely life-changing. And we just need to work for it. We need to work for each other. For a long time after my recovery, I held fast to the idea of what my life was before. I thought about the dreams that I had before this crash happened, and it was really, really hard for me to let that go, to understand that this was a new life. So I started to see a therapist. His name is Dr. Robert Gordon, and he is a peach. I just love him. And I'm gonna give you guys some insights from him. No copay. when I was seeing him, he was like, well, you know, why don't you see this as an opportunity? Why don't you reframe it? Yes, you're not gonna have the life that you had before, but what do you want from this one? Who was the person that you were before you almost died? Who's the person that left the crash? What do you want from this fragile, beautiful life? And whenever I'm brought with that kind of a question, I have to do what I always do, which is to make a list. So I started to make a list, and the title of it was Create the Life You Want to Live. And in it, I made a list of things that I thought would make up a beautiful life. It ranged from eating the best 50 sandwiches in New York City to trying to get to the top of the Statue of Liberty, and then finally taking a Pilates class, which, as you can tell, I was a very optimistic wheelchair-bound person. But what it did was that it allowed for me to understand that although this life was going to be different, it didn't make it any less beautiful. And as long as I chose it, then it could be spectacular. After the accident, as I mentioned, I was rushed into the emergency room, and the doctor who spoke to me did tell me that I was probably going to die, and she told me to, if I had any things to tell my family or my friends or my boyfriend, and I had to say I'm sorry, like on the hospital bed for a fight that I'd gotten into with my boyfriend the night before, which was the stupidest fight, but it was funny to be telling a stranger about it. But in that moment, she was like, you know, you're probably going to die, so just prepare yourself as much as one can. So I said my Hail Marys as I had the oxygen mask being put on my face. And she came within about 15 minutes of being right. They gave me an hour after 4 hours of surgery before they were going to stop resuscitating, until they were gonna stop giving me blood. And with about 15 minutes left, my blood suddenly started to clot, which was to the great chagrin of my family, where they were like, really had to wait until the last minute there, Kate. Thanks a lot. I was like, you guys, I've always been a procrastinator. The entire thing is like, job done. But that was the first in a series of no's. The second time was when the doctor told me that I was never gonna walk again. And what I will tell you is in the last year, I've run 2 half marathons. They have been, oh, thank you. But I So, like, that's all that you can take. It's like, there's only so much impact all the metal in my body can manage. Just like, Katie, relax. But I did them on there, and you should have seen me at the gym. Everybody was like, could you go? It's been over an hour and a half. And I was like, just a minute. Throwing water at myself, saying, go, Katie, to myself. But in that half marathon, my fastest one, I ran it in an hour and 37 minutes, which is 7 minute and 13 second splits. And then there was the last doctor who told me that I would never, ever live a normal life. I would never walk unaided, and that I would probably be in the care of my parents for the rest of my life. And I guess he's the one who was the closest to right, right? Because I don't live a normal life. My life is extraordinary. And the reason why I share this with you is because in every single one of those instances, these doctors were leaders in their fields. They were brilliant medical professionals, but they underestimated just one thing, the power of the human spirit. Mm-hmm. And if I'd been a different person, one with less hope, with less determination, then I would have leaned into what they told me would happen. And I would have either let myself die or stayed in the hospital bed or wheelchair and say, this is my life now, and I have no power to change it. Instead of giving up, I focused on something that my dad would say to me every night before he left me. My mom and dad had left me. My mom would kiss me goodbye, and my dad would come over to my hospital bed, and he would linger for an extra minute. And he would just whisper in my ear. He'd go, okay, Katie girl, I know you're in the fight of your life. You're getting the crap kicked out of you. He's like, but I need you to keep punching. Can you do that for me? Can you just keep swinging? You don't have to win. Just keep swinging until tomorrow morning. If you could do that for me, I'd really appreciate it. He reminded me that they're still fighting me, and that I had been weakened, but there was still a strength that couldn't be touched, and that I still had access to, that with hard work and determination, I could grow and I could multiply. And as long as I was brave and I didn't give up. I oftentimes forget the strength that exists inside of me, and I wanted to remind you of the strength that exists in you. This is a strength that maybe you haven't had to call on, but I want to make sure that you know that it's there, waiting to support you when you might need it. The last thing that I want to talk to you about is gratitude. And this is a funny thing that I will tell you that you guys, hopefully you won't ever have to know, but when you almost die, people want to talk to you about being grateful. All the time. It was like the number one thing that people wanted to talk to me about. They would be like, aren't you so happy that you survived? Aren't you so grateful that you're not dead? And I was like, oh yeah, I'm super amped about what's happening here. This is great. But it's a reasonable question, and I get it, but they were just trying to understand why a bad thing had happened to someone who they believed to be a good person. And it was just really hard for me to take because I was still using a urinary catheter because my bladder didn't function and I still couldn't feel my body below my ribcage. When you almost die, you get put into this other category where you're lucky to be alive. But I didn't understand that because if we're all breathing, aren't we all survivors? Aren't we all lucky to be alive? I just didn't understand why this really bad thing had to happen to me and then have to sit with people as they talked to me about being grateful for it. This was my line of thinking before I went and moved back in with my parents. They were in their 50s. My youngest brother had just gone away to college, and I'm one of four. So they had like 1 month of empty nesting, and then I was like, hey, guys. I couldn't do anything by myself. They had to bathe me, to feed me, to move me from my hospital bed into the bathroom, and they actually turned the entire first floor of our home into a makeshift hospital.
Yeah, sure.
And you'd think that they would be really upset about it, but they were total gems. Interestingly enough, my dad started buying champagne by the case. Oh. It was amazing. Like, and it was winter, so it was in the garage, so it was like easy access. Like, we didn't have to put it in a fridge. And any time that someone would come over, whether it was 7 o'clock on a Saturday or 10 a.m. on a Tuesday, he would rush up the garage and get a bottle. And then he'd run to our like china cabinet that I never saw in my life before this, and he'd get like our finest crystal, and he would hand it to the guest, one to me in my hospital bed, and he'd pour one for himself. And he would raise his glass and he would say, always, always remember life is a celebration.